permission to speak here. Well, the serial first is a new bind ground on voltage 2 free entropies, because this will be the main topic in my talk. I will remind you the some motivation from fundamental algebraic applications, even though this won't be the main subject. But let me remind you the definition. Okay, you take x1, xn, self-adjoint variables in your preferred 2-1 factor. Then Voigt-Toulis 2 considered the way they can be approximated by matrices, in considering first the set of macrostates associated to those variables. Thus, you have to fit the size of the matrix space in which you want to look at your macrostates, the order of approximations in terms of moments, in terms of how precise you want your approximation to be. Thus, you consider a bunch of the set of self-adjoint matrices such that they are in n by n matrices. They approximate, if you look at the trace of non-commutative polynomials, and do self-adjoint matrices, the normalized trace, you want to be close to the trace of your non-commutative polynomial in S1, Sn, okay, up to order epsilon for all p, which will be a monomial of order less than k. And then you consider some volumes for those microstates. Of course, Voigt-Toulis 2 considered Lebesgue measure, but since I will use free Brownian motion, I will consider a slight variant using Gaussian measures. Thus, the basic probability measure I start with is the law of the GUE. This is only a Gaussian measure on your set of self-adjoint matrices. And you have a natural covariance that fits the normalization. In order to have a possible limit at the right order, you ask for the covariance of its psi star under your low Pn to be 1. Thus, then you can consider, you can follow the Voigt-Toulis 2 to define macrostate free entropy as follows. First, you consider the log of the volume for your Gaussian measure of your macrostates. Then you consider a normalization, 1 over n squared. In the Gaussian setting, you don't need any other normalization. Then you take the lim sup when n goes to infinity. And finally, you approximate better and better. Oops, and here, this is an n. You take the infimum over the k and the epsilon. Well, this is, again, not exactly the Voigt-Toulis 2's definition, because I removed the condition that the matrices has to be bounded by some norm R. And this is the result, actually, of Berkovici and Bellinci, that this is the same as the definition of given by Voigt-Toulis 2. No need of a extra bound. AI below R, for R large enough. Okay, that's the definition that Voigt-Toulis 2 suggested for free entropy, and the first definition. And of course, he obtained lots of applications to fundamental algebras. Let me remind you a few. This, of course, the most famous one by Voigt-Toulis 2 himself is probably the fact that if this entropy is finite, well, with the normalization finite here means greater than minus infinity, then the fundamental algebra generated by your variables has no Cartan subalgebra. And of course, this was the first example of a C'est pas probable to one factor having no cation stable, je crois. Now we know much more of examples by plenty of other techniques, especially by deformation rigidity, but this was the first example. Then, of course, there have been a lot of followers, Liminger, Surin, Ken, and I worked on plenty of other properties, and I just want to emphasize recent progress last year by Ben Hayes. Well, they say that if you have, well, I don't consider really free entropy dimension in my talk, I will only state it with the assumption of finite entropy, but of course this is valid for, in case of free entropy dimension strictly above one. Thus, if you have a finite free entropy, then you cannot have certain chains of intrusions like that. So there is no chain which starts, this is an ordinal chain, you start at n0 to be hyperfinite. At each stage, you take a really weak notion of normalizer. Well, let me not state the most general notion, just consider the quasi-normalizer of your previous step, and you take the weak closure. And of course, at each limit ordinal step, you take union and you take then also a weak closure. And then what Ben proved is that you cannot end in such a chain by your algebra of your variables. Thus, there is no chain like that, starting at hyperfinite, such that W star of x1, xn is actually your last n lambda, one point in the chain. Okay, and the quasi normalizer, one-sided normalizer of an algebra, is a really weak notion of being a normalizer. This is a set of elements in your, well, let's call it M, your ambient algebra, such that if you you can find other elements in your previous algebra, such that each n is included in the sum of n x1. Okay. This one are not behind M. Yes. Okay, you quasi normalize your algebra with the elements, of course, outside M, and this, otherwise, this is not really. This should be it. Okay. Thus, you don't have in that way chains of really weak normalizers. This is a motivation, all those wonderful applications to fundamental algebras still gives after 20 years after the definition of Vautrelet's clue motivation to study free entropy. The main issue, of course, is that you don't have an easy way to compute free entropy. The only case for which Vautrelet's clue find a really nice formula is the case of one variable. In that case, let me remind you that the free entropy is merely given by some logarithmic energy. Thus, you consider your measure associated, your law associated to each. Then you have your logarithmic energy. And of course, since I took the Gaussian variant, you have to change by adding twice of x squared, and you have always a constant. But basically, up to a Gaussian term, this free entropy is the logarithmic energy. Thus, in order to find a general formula in that spirit for the several variable case, Vautrelet's clue defined the second free entropy, the non-microstates free entropy. And of course, the main conjecture in this subject is to be able to prove that the two entropy coincide. Let me remind you the second definition of Vautrelet's clue. Okay. Thus, again, I will state it slightly differently than the original to fit to the Gaussian framework. Thus, you consider a process which is what is called in probability a Boolean bridge. Basically, you want that at time one you get your process, and you want that, near zero, this is the you have three semicircular variables on your process that will dominate. You force somehow your three semicircular variables to arrive at time one at your x you want. This x is a bunch of x1, xn, and which is free from s equal s1, sn, which are three semicircular variables. Then Voigt-Toulescu showed that there is those variables satisfying the kind of Schwinger-Dyson equation in the spirit of what Elise defined this morning. That's what is at least a statement. Well, there is, for all those things, a certain variable, xti, in the fundamental algebra generated by xt, such that the Schwinger-Dyson equation is satisfied. Thus, this gives the trace of xti p. The formula is given by trace tensor trace of the non-commutative derivative of p. Here, p is any non-commutative polynomial. Vi is Voigt-Toulescu's free difference quotient that you sum over all decomposition of p as a xi b, and you replace the xi by your tensor sign. Okay. And xti has to be, which is really crucial, in the fundamental algebra generated by xt, or in the L2 space, but here this is in the fundamental algebra, actually. Okay, and then Voigt-Toulescu has a formula for that should be give the same as his version before, which is non-microstate entropy. And it is defined as follows. This is an integral from 0 to 1 of, well, and in the normalization I have here, this is xt over t minus ct in two norms squared. Okay. This morally, this is some integral produced by integrating some norm squared of ct of the what is called the conjugate variable. I should call this ct is the conjugate variable of x. Well, the question is, can we actually prove that the two quantities are equal? This is a really technical question, and we don't know much about that. We didn't know much about that before. Well, what do we know is first by, of course, by the work of Voigt-Toulescu, we know that everything is equal in the case n equal 1. T equal T star if n equal 1, or in the free case, or for free variables. And by the work of Bian, Capitaine, and Guyonnet, we know that you always have an inequality. T is always below T star. Anyway. Beyond that, we didn't have much example. Thus, my main result is to explain you one new example where we actually know equality of t and t star. Okay. The theorem is as follows. It will be expressed in terms of certain condition and the conjugate variable of some state. Thus, you have to take a potential. The conjugate variable will derive from a potential, as in the examples Alice gave in one variable this morning. Thus, you take V, what will be your potential. Thus, well, let me say in general that it should be bounded below subquadratic Well, it would be convex. C1, the gradient of V should be Lipschitz. Some conditions like that. And let me give you a concrete example. This would be more clear than the technical conditions rather than defining them technically. But basically, what I have in mind, V, is some quadratic term plus some perturbation, a small perturbation, by something which is sufficiently nice to be infinitely differentiable and we have in bounding derivatives. I need only two bounding derivatives, but let's only write something which is actually infinitely many bounded derivatives. Just to do that, I will it fits in terms of unitary variables associated to is. The UI is your clearly transform that goes from the real line to the unitary variables. Thus, let's say this is its plus 4 square root minus 1 over its I minus 4 square root minus 1. OK. Thus, you get you take a potential like that. Thus, you choose lambda m small enough to get the convexity condition. Then, what Alice and Dima showed a couple of years ago is that there is a unique trace to V such that the conjugate it has conjugate variable, let's say it's I plus di V. This is a way. Its I is a way to say actually this is strictly it has to be strictly convex. Here I in your you don't write it to V usually you would. No. I just take this one convex, not strictly convex, and then I have the psi to make it strictly convex, right? That's only a way of phrasing things. Of course, I could increase this one and not have this one. Okay, the series is a unit trace tau that has conjugate variable these elements, corresponding to the law of some its one, its n. And then for this unit trace satisfying Schwinger-Dyson equation, as Alice said, called this equation, then you have that Tj of its one, its n is actually equal to Tg star. All right. Okay, that's why it is not a priori such obvious. You say that using the convexity, you are able to treat small perturbations somehow of quadratic. But let me point out one point. Note that even with the very recent technology of free transport, which also applies to small perturbations of quadratic, it was unknown that we have this result. Basically, because we know a change of variable for chi, but we don't know a nonlinear change of variable for chi star, for non-microstate free entropy. Thus, even if you are able to transport to show that the fundamental algebras corresponding to these two states are isomorphic, it is because of the lack of technology at the present time to understand chi star, you cannot use this change of variable to actually prove something which is as natural as having equality of chi equal chi star. Okay. I think that I had something else to emphasize at this point. Yes. Of course, you should know that in the condition there is no V which is polynomial but non-quadratic. basically, because I asked from things which are subquadratic here, my perturbations, I really want them to be somehow way more bounding than polynomials. And that's crucial for the large deviation principle. And then, and moreover, well, this, of course, if you does not imply any thing related to conjugate embedded conjugate, sure. Because you don't have enough states. That's the ultimate goal, of course. If you were able to prove that for densely many states in your choice of variables, you have t equal t star, then you would get conjugate embedding conjecture. We are not yet at this stage. We are only doing small perturbation of quadratic, but that's already an improvement. Okay. Thus, mostly the other reason of the difficulty is that, well, my main result, as I said, is telling you that you have t equal to t star, okay, for certain variables. But actually, the idea of the proof is more that, well, it is really not clear that t star is the right definition for the something that should be given to t beyond those kind of examples. What I want to emphasize that there is some other candidates to replace k star for which this should be easier to prove an equality like that. And that was kind of the point that at the end you have to solve, you have to work more to check actually that for certain variables, your second candidate to be a non-microstate phenotype is equal to Boutroulet's loose definition. And this is where the difficulty is. But let me give you, before entering in the classical theorem in progress, for what is the right candidate to be your formula for chi star? Well, basically, I will write it for minus chi, because otherwise, you have difference. This is the this will follow more closely the usual sign for classical probability, and thus you will have minimization problem instead of maximization problems. Thus, I will tell you that what appears more naturally in the proof is instead of having an exact formula for k star where you know exactly at what process you want to evaluate something, what appears more naturally is a minimization problem. And the minimization problem is as follows. You consider some L2 norm of something. That's the same kind of thing as before, but this time you take the minimum of all ways of finding U in L2 adapted processes in some filtration G. Then you ask for, of course, that the law of your, you have your free Brownian motion in this filtration. You have your S plus S1 plus the integral from 0 to 1 of US dS. And you want to impose that the law of this thing is equal to the law of your X1 itself. Okay. Oh, now I will complement by some extra conditions in my minimization process. First I have to tell you on what G I have to choose. Thus, the one I think has a chance to work is the following condition that I will call, as it is called in model theory, an elementary embedding of F. Okay, thus, F, I take my classical filtration for free Brownian motion. Fs is the value star of x1, xn. S t below S. Then, you can imagine that, recently, you know, there is an axiomatization in an abstract model theory of Feynman algebras, and you can axiomatize each algebra of your filtration one by one. And well, you add some natural axioms for filtration and containing one process, but you can imagine what is there is a theory of filtration. Okay. Then what I mean here is that G is elementarily equivalent, an elementary embedding, sorry. This, well, this means that lots of things you can say about the free Boolean filtration is also true for your G. And basically, what does it give you? As it gives you that for sure ST is a free Boolean motion in your filtration. This implies, this is not equivalent to that, but this implies that free has to be a free Boolean motion in G. Thus, all increments have to be free from the past. Well, you have all of a lot more properties, especially you know that, elementarily equivalent, and I say, didn't say, of course, I want to take something G reasonable, this all GS have to be separable. Separable pretty all. But anyways, those GS can always be embedded in ultrapowers of G. The GS is included in any ultrapower of FS. But that's basically the idea. you allow more filtration than merely the free Boolean filtration in order to get some compactness. You basically want to take any separable filtrations, lots of separable filtrations built in an ultrapower, to get some, to have a chain that your infimum here is attained. And actually that the, your level set of this function will be compact as you want for a good weight function. Okay. Thus I slightly improved my sketch of theorem in progress, but I still have to say that I don't expect this exactly to be equal to that. What I expect, what I mean by that I will still have some regularization to do. But by the almost equal, I mean that ever you regularize in the law, basically you don't, you take a semi-continuous regularization of these things, you don't ask to be exactly equal in law, but to be close in law, and then you reduce. Ever take a semi-continuous regularization. Or you have another way, or you slightly weaken your assumption, or weaken what you ask for U into L2 add. Well, basically, you don't want that this integral here will be absolutely, gives you something absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure, you allow a few things which are not absolutely continuous. The expected, anyway, I don't want to emphasize this point. The crucial thing is whether that you have to consider more general filtrations to be able to get compactness. Okay. That's the expected kind of result. But now I want to explain you how you go to prove such kind of result, and I will mostly focus on the first theorem. Okay, and maybe, yes, in order to prevent a question Dima asked me a little earlier, let's note that from this fact here, you know that your filtration is actually embedded in L infinity omega, thus you impose in this condition that your law is X. Your quantity is minus infinity by definition, if, or plus infinity here by definition, the set is empty if it is not embedded in L of infinity omega. I take minimization, especially if it is not omega embeddable, I really put in my candidate for non-microstate for entropy something which forces omega embeddability, right? That just for things to be clear. Okay. Thus, what is the idea behind that? The idea is to rather consider a kind of Legendre transform of entropic quantities. Thus, let me remind you one thing. Well, here I need to not mix up signs to take my paper, because with the change of signs between free entropy and usual entropy, I mix up signs often. Let me remind you that the minus entropy. Quantity if, oui. Good. Thank you. The entropy of mu with respect to gamma has an expression in terms of a Lejeune transform that involves some kind of Laplace transform. If you take an infimum of a whole continuous bounded function of your of some linear affine plus your Laplace transform. Okay, that's another formulation of ordinary entropy. And thus, the technique to prove such a result is to study, instead of the limit of some entropic quantities, well, you know, the log of the measures I considered was only the entropy of some measure respected to a set with respect to your basic measure. Instead of considering the limit of entropies, you consider the limit of these kind of Laplace quantities. Okay. Let me skip the random matrix result in this respect for now and remind you a few background on the classical entropy techniques we will use. Basically, the techniques are related to actually being able to solve various kind of minimization problems like that explicitly in some cases. But of course, well, first I will just say in words that there is, for ordinary entropy, a formula like that, which is due to Fulmer. Thus, this is known. You also have to consider, in general, filtrations which are not Brownian, that's for sure. But basically, what I will say is that in the cases we are in, you don't need to consider non-Brownian filtrations to reach the infimum. I will start by the background on entropy and linear space. Okay, this here, of course, I will have gamma, the law of the Brownian motion. In any dimension I fix, since this is your matrices, your bunch of Hermitian matrices, thus on C0 of 0, 1 value in ARD. Then you have, of course, a dual formula for this one, expressing this in terms of this. And the formula goes as follows. It is well known. Your minus your Laplace functional is given by an infimum of all measures, well, absolutely continuous. And, well, of course, the term with entropy will be often infinite. Typically more measures with finite entropy, such of the corresponding quantity, f d gamma plus the entropy of mu with respect to gamma. Okay. That's a nice minimization problem, but it is not explicit for us because the entropy is in the right hand side, and thus you don't have a priori formulation valid for the candidate limit. Thus, you want to say that in some cases, you have a better formulation than that. The result is as follows. It is due to Bouet, Dupuis, and Ustunel. And it will give you another formulation, which will be in terms of a stochastic control problem, and for which the objects appearing in the right-hand side could have a limit in the object in the random matrix states. Okay, this is you need some assumption on F. Well, you need that exponential minus F is in LP and F is in LQ for conjugate values. And then what you have is that this infimum is actually an infimum over of the same time as before, over adapted processes of, basically you replace your entropy by the corresponding integral that you square norm that you had before. You call it spending energy for your control process. If you take the F at the law of your bounded motion perturbed by your integral along U, and well, I should maybe keep the same notation, integral from zero to dot to of U SDS, and you add the energy term, 1/2 of the integral from zero to one of U SDS. Okay. Thus, you have now a better formulation for your, and I didn't write that this was equal to, as before, to minus your Laplace functional. Thus, you have a better formulation for your Laplace functional that you want to take the limit in the matrix case, because you have a control formula, and every term you can make sense in a non-commutative filtration. Okay, but now what you need is actually a more restrictive kind of condition on F, so that you can know where exactly your infimum is wedged, and you can solve an equation so that your limiting objects will you can expect them to also solve the same equation. That's the second result of Fustunel. Even though that in the case where I will formulate it here, this is probably this was probably known before in control theory. Let me just state it here. A priori, the function is a function on the full full path of your Brownian motion. But let me just state the second version only for functions of terminal times of b1 plus the integral from 0 to 1. Probably b1. The function which is the terminal time function. Okay. Then, if your function is convex, well, what we know is that we have an expression. That you have the same infimization is wedged. And you have a system of equation for your infimization. If you call, actually, in control theory, this term US is called the control. Thus, if you call minus UIS the control, you have a pair of equations as follows. Well, first, I write the control equation, xt equal 0 plus bt plus the integral from, minus the integral from 0 to t of YS dS. So I have a linear control, and then I have a second equation about y in terms of hits. This is a conditional expectation on the on the past of my filtration of the gradient of the function I want to wedge at time 1 evaluated at my process hits at time 1. You see, this is a really coupled pair of equations where hits determines y and y determine hits. And we formulated in another way. You can reformulate this conditional expectation in terms of an over-stochastic integral. This is, you would write it in that way. You would, this is your terminal value minus some stochastic integral. That's the conditional expectation. That complements your projection here. Okay, this pair of equations has been studied a lot in classical probability. You have one equation which has an initial condition, xt. Here I wrote it with x0 equals 0. But let me maybe write it x plus that with x equals 0. And I have another equation which is backwards because it has a terminal condition at time 1. Okay. And well, these are called forward-backward stochastic differential equations. And this is the kind of equation that solves your problem. Now you want to check that under G convex, you can know sufficiently well the behavior of these kind of equations to be able to take some limit of them and control what happens. Okay, this I have to mention a last thing. But actually, in general, this YS is a gradient of some function HS of its S for this kind of formulation. And this function IHH satisfies also a minimization problem. But you have to consider the same problem as here, restricted to S1. Yes? That's it. But now I can give you the idea of the proof of the first theorem using this as a background. But, well, I should emphasize well, you have a Markov semigroup in the first here, in the first part. If you consider whether this thing, you have a nonlinear semigroup for this infimization problem, the cost function. But here, since you have a terminal and initial conditions, you don't have any more really semigroup for this kind of pair of equations. Thus, the idea of proof goes as follows. First, to explain it more easily, you basically start from the lower bound that you had here, that you expected here. Actually, you start from the lower bound above the infimum just on the filtration generated by free Brownian motion with US adapted to L2 add of F. The filtration of free Brownian motion. In that case, when you do that, you actually see that this is not really different than the lower bound that they add with that Bian Capitaine and Guyonne add in the result. But that's the safe lower bound when you only have here you consider things which solve strong stochastic differential equation in a strong sense because you are in the filtration exactly of your Brownian motion. Okay, thus now you want to produce something which in that. Oops, no, you don't do that, you do the other one. I already mixed up the sign. I want to bound below the entropy of T, but I want to bound above the other one. This, I will already put my minus sign to have a SERP, and now this is in the right order. Okay. Thus, a priori, my TG is. I want that bounded above by that. Okay. I restrict my set on which I think. I have a small supremum, but I have a minus sign. Thus, I have to find, basically, in the respect that this thing is equal to the supremum in that case, I have to find you the optimal one in that thing. I won't, if I notice, I have to guess what is the optimal one. Thus, I will guess the optimal one and check that it satisfies, exactly, this is the one coming in the Curie-Strauss formula. Okay. But to do that, you start from your random matrix intuition. You know that in the corresponding problem in the random matrices, the law of its T in the one satisfying your optimization problem would be exactly the law of your Brownian bridge I wrote before. This is the law of that kind, and it's in that case, of course, you want to take it. I wrote it for the free variant, but you think about that as the corresponding random matrix variant, right? Thus, you know that the random matrix variants actually satisfy also the same kind of maximization problem. But this is the one given by 1 over n squared log of integral of n squared over n trace of v of b1. V is the potential I raised at v of b1 with respect to your Gaussian measure. That's your measure for your free Brownian motion. Okay? And this is an infimum of by the result E applied to random matrices of some 1 over n trace of V of its plus 1 half of 0, 1, the some US n depending on the size of the matrix squared. with S1 equal to as before B1 plus integral from 0 to 1 of USDS. As you know where this infimum is wedged, the infimum satisfies this pair of equations that I wrote before. This way, write the equations, is T and C, what they give at the limit. And what do you know a priori? Ys is equal to my gradient Hs n of its 1, of its s, and is equal to the expectation of the gradient g of its 1. Okay. But normally, if everything is fine, at the end, I should take Us to be exactly minus this Ys. But this is what I will do. I will take all those things in some ultra powers. And I hope that actually the solution, I will be able to solve it in the free Brownian filtration. That's why I am able to do that. Well, first, because of the convexity of the terminal law, you can use some Bose-Comeplib inequalities following Alice and Edouard Morel-Segala to check actually that its t is, those its tn, you see, I should write n everywhere, those its tn are actually uniformly, can be, are almost uniformly bounded, and thus you can write them when if you take your topology in the fundamental algebra of topology. Where your mn here is mn of L infinity of gamma. Okay. The threshold from the manageable ultra power. Well, a priori, your ys are also in an L2 ultra power, but with thanks to the first equation, since you also know that bt can be taken in the manageable ultra power, it is not too hard to show that it is in actually in the L2 space of the manageable ultra power. And not in the topology of L2 spaces. Okay? Well, but this is not yet enough. You basically want to use something that you will know thanks to your control problem on HS. And I didn't tell you that, and I am almost out of time. How much time do I have? Good. The HS, what do I know by general result? We know, of course, it is Lipschitz. It is a easy to see on this kind of expression that if you add an its here to, and you get something on S1, you get something Lipschitz function in its, if f is Lipschitz. This is easy. What is less easy is to check that from the terminal condition convex, you get g, this thing is convex. That's the key thing. And then, thanks to that, you get that the gradient of HSN is also Lipschitz. What is always the case, because of the infimization problem here, that H is a kind of semi-concave, that the gradient should be bounded above. But thanks to the convexity here, it is actually also bounded below, and thus you have exactly Lipschitz. You check that all these things are uniform in N, that then the same thing appears at the limit. Thus you have a function also H, S, N, omega defined on here. And you check that your corresponding ultra product thing satisfies the same equation in the ultra product. But now, for small time, for on 1 minus delta 1, there is a strong solution, an a priori result, that all those kind of things have a strong solution. That is a solution adapted to the Brownian filtration. Thus, you have a strong solution on that. That's actually the solution you built in the ultra product has also to live at for the terminal part in a better space, in the free product. Okay. But now, thanks to your a priori estimates that are valid all along your path, you can reduce your previous problem to by changing your terminal G by H1 minus delta. And since your a priori estimates were uniform in S here, you can iterate your process and have all the solution on zero delta. Then change G to one H one minus delta and get solution on 0, 1. Okay. Thus, now once you get that, actually your process that you build a priori in the top product is lives actually in a plane algebra of your free Brownian motion, and it appears in this infimum, and you can compare it to this, and then you do the same as Bian, Capitaine, and Guyonnet, you check that your YS satisfy is the right thing with respect to Brownian motion. Thus YS is the CC was it's T over T minus CT with respect to conjugate variables. That is the same as Bn capital Bn. Okay. And then you can conclude. Thank you for your attention. Well, if you, I don't know what do you mean by the first, because Alice and Philippe and Mireille, when they proved their inequality, also considered Brownian motion and thus get enough theorems and these things that gives you matrix Brownian motion. This is not the first study. Even in the moreover in the one variable case, there were really plenty of study of stochastic processes and. In one of matrices. Yes. Yes, that's. I stated the result for convex. The problem is that those potentials which are convex are not dense in any way. The convexity is not dense. That's why. The point is that to go beyond the convex case, you have to use somehow different techniques to check this. You can get something Lipschitz. Basically, you have to use different techniques of forward backward stochastic differential equations to go starting at something convex to improve the non-convexity a lot. That's for the theorem in progress. You need something more that, to go beyond convex here by using other techniques specific to forward backward stochastic differential equation, not having an a priori estimates from stochastic control. That's the idea.